welcome to Talking Sopranos. This week we are going to delve into season one, episode 7, Down Neck. But we have a very special guest who is featured in this episode. A good friend of ours, a great guy, fantastic actor. Please welcome Robert Iler.
Yes, Robert. Sir.
Hey, guys.
Yes, sir.
There he is.
What's going on?
It's been a while.
Thanks for coming on.
Good to see you guys. I'm great, man. I'm just, dealing with all the craziness that's going on. And this is a nice, this is a nice thing to do during it. I'm always happy to see you guys.
I haven't seen you in quite a while.
Yeah, I did. Like, it's weird leaving New York. You know, I never lived anywhere besides New York my whole life. So being away from all the Sopranos guys is weird. But the good side is I get to see Jamie nonstop. I'm seeing Jamie.
And Jamie Lynn's like your sister in real life.
She is like my sister in real life. She's
Jamie Lynn who played better. Now, do you drive?
I don't drive. I take Ubers.
So you don't know how, do you have a license?
I got my license when I was like 16, just that like initial wanting to get out of the house and get away. And then I got into a really bad car accident when I was like 22 or 23. I wasn't even driving, but when I was 22, 23, and ever since then, I get anxiety from driving.
I'm with you.
I didn't start till I was like 30, you know.
Really?
Yeah. Because of the Sopranos, you know, and the pilot, I smashed the car on camera with Jim in the car. And I didn't know. And they said, well, if you come back, if the show gets picked up, you got to get a license. And so I did. But I wouldn't rule it out for you. I mean, I know it's, you know, you had an accent, so it's anxiety and you know, you might be a little scared. But living in California, being able to drive is a lot. Makes it a lot more enjoyable, I think.
How did you deal with leaving New York? And you were in New York your whole life too, right?
Yeah, I left, but I never really worked. I don't live in LA, I live in Santa Barbara. And now I live in New York, back and forth, the last like 2 years or year and a half. Now that my kids are almost out of the house. But the thing is, I don't work Santa Barbara, so I was always, I was in New York a lot. I was everywhere else. So, you know, but driving actually really helps because there's something really, I mean, I drive to LA sometimes for meetings or events or stuff like that. And I actually really like it, the drive, you know, it's really beautiful.
Not me. I have a house down in Southern California. I don't drive. I only drive in the neighborhood.
Not on the highway, no?
Not on the highway no more. No, I can't drive after dark. I'm an old fat man. I can't do these things, guys.
It's old ladies driving on. Like 80 old ladies driving cars.
They drive like lunatics in California.
They do.
I admit fast. Too fast, too slow.
Even though I'm like a younger, thinner guy, I kind of lived my whole life like an old fat man. It's just how I feel, you know? It is.
Now, weren't you living in Vegas for a while?
Yeah, I lived in Vegas for a little over a year, like a year and a half when I was like 25. And then I moved back to New York. That's kind of when I got sober. And then I moved back to Vegas thinking like, oh, it'd be the same. And I moved there. And when I got there, I realized, oh, being sober, this place is not for me.
Gotcha. And now you're 35 now?
Yeah, I just turned 35.
35. See, we still think of him, right, Michael? You think of you like as a kid, like a little kid. You're a grown goddamn man.
35. How old were you when we did the pilot?
I was 12.
Wow. Was that your first acting job?
No, I had. So I started doing commercials when I was 6 years old. I did a lot of commercials, and I did like IBM and Pizza Hut and AT&T, and then my grandmother passed away. I broke my arm. Like all this weird kind of stuff happened. And my mom took me, or we just got out of it. And then my manager kept calling, you know, every couple months. So would you come back? Would you come back? And finally we said, I got like the cast off my arm and things were kind of getting back to normal in my family. And I said, okay, I'll go back. And then that was it. Got Sopranos.
And so you auditioned. Tell me when you auditioned. Did you audition first for the casting people? Do you remember? I don't know if you remember. Casting people, then David, what, tell me.
I don't really remember a lot of details. What I do remember is after the audition, my mom was pissed because we left. And she's like, it was a room full of 100 Italian kids. Like, you know, like they had like the slick back hair and like leather jacket, and they were trying to be like the Sopranos.
Oh, really? Is that what it was? Like little mob guys?
Yeah. And I was, you know,
little Chrissies. They were like being little Chrissies.
Yeah. And I was, you know, 200 pounds with freckles, as Irish as could be, like. And David, I always remember that every time I said fuck in the audition, David laughed every time. So like I would do it, come back, do it. He laughed. And then finally they were just like, yeah, they're like, you got the role.
And did it tell you right there in the room, or were you at home?
No, I think I was actually at school, and my mom called. Because so what happened was when we found out I got Sopranos, that was it. My family was like, this is it. Like, you're going to be famous. You're going to be on a TV show. It's going to be the biggest thing at Boba. And then when we went and shot the pilot, I said that. And Tony Sirico was like, no, that's not how this works. He's like, we shoot these things all the time. We're never going to see each other again. So I had to go back and tell my family, like, nah, this isn't it. You know, this isn't the thing. It's not. And they were all like bummed and everything. And then, you know, then the billboard came in Times Square, and
yeah, they were right. Tony was wrong.
Yeah, exactly.
But you know, I haven't watched the shows since they first aired. You know what I mean? I haven't gone back since the shows were on TV.
Right.
And I'm watching them in order. So I watched the first 7. And I'm not blowing smoke. I'm not just saying this because you're here and because you're my friend. But your acting is phenomenal. It's really good. Especially in the pilot, simple, honest, in the moment, you're so relaxed, you're so natural. Your work is great. It was throughout the show. I mean, but I hadn't seen it in a while, so I'm reminded how good. Were you studying acting? Did you have a teacher? Like, was it all instinctual, or what was that? What was that process for you?
Well, thank you. Obviously, it means a lot coming from you. I never studied any kind of acting, never did anything. But I definitely, because I never thought that I was good. But I feel like around the end, not that I got good, but I was kind of able to at least hold my own. And when I was comfortable, and I felt okay. And like, sometimes obviously it was from being around Jim and Edie and people like you guys, and just watching, because a lot of times people are like, oh, what did Jim teach you? And it's like, you know, Jim never came to me and tried to, you know, put me under his arm and be like, here's what you got to do, and this is what you, but when you're around him and Edie and doing scenes with it, it's just like you pick up stuff, you learn stuff, you see how they do it, and that's all you know. You're like, oh, this is how you do it.
Yeah, well, right. You did this stuff instinctively. I mean, you're really, really good. Like, even in this episode coming up, I mean, you have a great scene with Jim where you were going to the dentist, and he asks you if you know, and you tell him that the kid said he might be in the mafia. It's so good. You're so good, seriously. No bullshit. And it's, I guess, done. You knew what to do, whether you were taught it or not. You instinctively knew what to do. You know, and this is way back at the beginning, and never mind, later on, you became a terrific actor. But why'd you stop? Did you not love it? Did you get nervous about it? Did you get anxiety? Like, you know, why did you just stop?
Because you. What was the last thing you did?
After Sopranos, I told my manager that I wanted 6 months off to go play poker and hang out with my friends and just do whatever. And then he just kept calling, you know, it's been a year, it's been 2 years. And I'm like, I don't want to. And the only thing I really have done since Sopranos was when I got a call to do jury duty. And I didn't want to go do jury duty. So I called my manager, and he's like, well, I could get you a job, and it'll get you out of doing jury duty. So I'm like, all right, fine. So he called me, and I did twice to get out of jury duty. I did an episode of Law & Order.
Yeah, but didn't they want you?
That's very funny.
Yeah. What did they want you for, a big HBO show after The Sopranos, like Band of Brothers or one of those, something in the Pacific, something that you had a shot?
There were shows that, not HBO that I remember, but I remember one like movie, I got a great offer, and then like a bunch of shows, and still, like, you know, I still get calls to randomly to do shows, and I just, I don't know, it's not that I get anxiety about it, it's more so like the things that I've done since Sopranos or working on other things, it's like I just get that feeling of like, oh, this, it's like you played for the Yankees and now people are like, hey, do you want to go do this thing that it's, you know, you don't know if it's going to be good. You're not like there. When you went to, I feel like with Sopranos, there was no, like, you just knew every episode was going to be great. Every scene was going to be great. Every person you were acting with was going to be great. And since the only thing I ever really did was this 10-year thing, I guess I have a fear of like, wow, what if I went to go do something and I hated it? And then they just kept offering you money and this thing's going to go for 10 years and I'm stuck in this thing that as much as I love Sopranos, what if I hate this thing, you know?
And so you always loved to play poker, even while the show was going on, right?
Yeah.
So you used to play what? In a lot of games here in New York, right?
Yeah. Like, I played at some underground spots in New York, but I was also like, we had 3 days off and it was like, get in the car, go to Atlantic City or go to Mohegan Sun or go wherever. And I would just love, like, it was something that I could do. Like, it's one of the, you know, when like a kid, like a little kid watches a movie and you're like, aren't you sick of watching that movie? You're always watching the same, like you watch that movie 100 times. You can't, that's how I was with poker. Like I could just, over and I could sit there for 12 hours, play poker, go to sleep, wake up, and all I wanted to do was play poker.
Do you still play?
Yeah, I still play. That's so I moved to LA 6 months ago, but before that I was living in Vegas and I was playing all the time. And I definitely don't love it as much as I used to, but I still, it's just, there's something about it. It's like the only thing I was good at in school really was math. So it's like, the math side of it, and then it's like figuring out what people are thinking, and I just, it's, I love it.
And you're making a living. That's how you make your living.
Yeah. I have in the past. Now it's, you know, I'm not really playing enough at all to make a living, but also like I was drinking a lot back in the day, so I would make money playing poker, and then I would go lose it, like, you know, betting on. Yeah. Sports or you know, roulette, like trying to make it out of the casino was, because I would always play poker sober, I wouldn't drink, and then well, after I won.
Who's that sound like? Stu Unger. You know, we did a movie about that. Stu Unger, who's like the Babe Ruth of the World Series of Poker. Michael played Stu Unger, I played his friend. Yeah, and Stu Unger would play cards, win, and then blow hundreds and hundreds of thousands of dollars on, you know, horses and baseball and football, you know.
Yeah. I mean, blackjack, he
would, and, you know, yeah. If he stuck to the poker, he would have been fine, but that's not the case. Gambling's gambling, right?
Yeah, he had other problems as well, but like with drugs and stuff like that, that took him down. But yeah, it wasn't the money, you know. He was addicted to the action, you know what I mean? It wasn't about winning as much as it was just action. And listen, gambling, you know, triggers, you know, the serotonin and endorphin and your brain chemistry like drugs do.
For sure.
You know, yeah. So there's that, you know, which is why like blackjack, I could play for hours and not get tired. You know, it's like you're in that kind of heightened state, and then you get, you know, even when I win a little bit, I have to force myself to leave the table because I'll just keep playing. You know, it's not even about the money that you know, that's, I guess, what separates a professional from a degenerate, right? They know when to walk away.
So, Robert, how long have you been sober now?
I haven't been drunk in like over 7 years. And then drugs is probably like hardcore drugs is like seven years. But then like, I was taking Xanax every day, so it took me a long time to get off of Xanax, and I had to go see like a specialist. So that's probably been
good, man.
5 years with the Xanax.
Well, good for you. So during the Soprano years, now the show ended 2007. You were in your early 20s, right?
Yeah, I was probably 22 when it ended.
So you're on this show. You were out in the clubs every night, right?
Every night, yeah.
Were you dating any famous broads here? Lindsay Lohan, who was big back then? Paris Hilton, Lindsay Lohan, you banging any of these broads?
They were all big back then. You know what? I was more like regular chill. Like I definitely have hooked up with some girls who people know, whatever. But it's more, I was more of like not having to work hard and dating regular chicks, you know? Because if you're dating, you know, Paris Hilton, Lindsay Lohan, that's, you're working. You're, you know, there's guys trying to call her and date her nonstop every day and trying to be the next big and send flowers and this. And I'm just never, I never was like a work too hard at a relationship kind of guy. Like, I'm like, oh, if it's going to work, it's going to work. And when you try and date those kind of girls, that's not really how it goes.
Did you ever see Lady Gaga again after? Because Lady Gaga was an extra, basically, in the scene when you kind of vandalized the swimming pool in your school. Before she was Lady Gaga, she was an actress, I guess, trying to be an actress.
Yeah, we have some mutual friends in New York, but I actually saw her like 3 months ago at a friend's birthday party out here in L.A. And it's just like, not that I would go up and say hi, but everybody, you could feel that vibe of like, you know, she was sitting by like a fire pit and there's 10 people around and you could tell like 9 of those 10 people are just trying to like watch her out of the corner of their eye, and it made me super uncomfortable. And I was like,
and did she come over and say hello to you?
No, she didn't say hi to me. I didn't say hi to her. I was just like, cause like I'm the opposite. Like I move, when I feel that, like, you know, everybody wants to talk to this person, I'm the opposite. Like, I'm like, I want to get out of here and move away from that.
You know, you were younger then, but you were very much part of the cast. Now, I know you say you don't watch the show, but at the premieres, you had to see some of it.
Oh, yeah, at the premiere. So I've seen the first episode of every season, and some seasons are the first two episodes.
So you have seen some of your work.
Yeah, I've seen some. But I think for me, like, the premieres were different, right? Because you're watching it with like, how many people fit in Radio City? Like a couple thousand?
5,000-6,000.
Yeah, so you're watching it with like 6,000 people. People are laughing. You're with 10 friends and family members and you're joking around. So it's not the same to me as like sitting down in my living room and going to On Demand and actually watching an episode. You know, it's because like I was watching a movie that I didn't know James was in. And like, I was however many minutes into it. And then he popped on the screen and I shut it off. I was like, I can't sit here and watch it because I'm not watching the movie. You know, I'm just like, I'm in my head and I'm thinking about him and times we had and this and, you know.
So there's a lot of episodes that you've never, ever seen.
I've probably not seen like 80% of the episodes yet. Like,
and why is that?
When I was younger, it was definitely a lot of like uncomfortable watching myself. It still is that, but even more so now, it's like to watch 80 hours of videos of Jim, to me would feel like torture, you know? Like
And you were very close to Jim. I mean, we all were, but you were especially close. You thought of him as a father figure in real life, no?
Well, that's, you know, the crazy thing is like, He met me when I was 12 and we started doing the show, and like, you know, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, it was very father figure. And, you know, we were on set and he's like, Edie was talking about how she's doing a play. And I was like, oh, I've never seen a play. And he whipped his head around. He's like, what? What do you mean you've never seen a play? So then like a week later, he called me. He's like, I got us tickets to a play. You know, we're going to see a play. And then as I became 16, 17, 18, and he would see me more like at the events, always with a vodka cranberry or, you know, always drinking. And then he started treating me, you know, more like one of the guys. And by the time I was 22 when we finished, it was like 100%, you know, just one of the guys. But it was weird for me, like finding that, coming into that. Because in the beginning, guys, you know, Michael, I could feel the like, I would be drunk and it would be obvious and I would get that like, kind of like, you know, maybe you shouldn't be, you know, you're only 16 and blah, blah, blah. And then as, you know, it's, you know, 19, 20, 21, you felt more like it wasn't weird when you ordered a drink in front of everyone, you know?
So Rico, did he say something? Tony usually has advice. He usually gives fatherly advice out, warranted or unwarranted.
Yeah, he always just told me, if you ever have any problems, you call Uncle Tony. And I said, okay. He told me that he came to my confirmation. However old you are when you get your confirmation, is that like 13 or 14? And he came in like the three-breasted like pinstripe suit, and he gave me a kiss on the cheek with a card with cash in it. And he's like, you ever have any problems, you call Uncle Tony and this. And I was like, oh, okay.
How much did he give you? I hope he gave you $1,000.
He definitely gave me more than anyone else at the party. I remember that. I don't know how much
he did. He was always very generous.
Very generous guy.
Yeah, yeah.
You think you'll go back to acting ever?
I could. You know, there's times where I think no, never. And then there's times where, like, you know, last week in this like quarantine where I was watching Ozark. I don't know if you guys watch Ozark on Netflix.
My wife does, yeah. It's good, yeah. Right?
It's like Jason Bateman, and one of the episodes was, or a few of the episodes, was directed by Alex Sakharov, who did Sopranos. And it was just, I mean, it blew me away. Like, I was watching it, and I was like, holy shit, this is... So there's times where I'm sitting at home watching that, and I'm like, I could see doing something like this, like, and I would really enjoy it, but... It's, you know, I think what people, because, you know, a lot of people hear that, like, I don't want to do acting, and they kind of give me shit about it and this. And I think a lot of people who don't know stuff about acting is like, it's not Sopranos, you know, 99% of the shit you're going to do, it's not what we had and what we did. And then, of course, you know, some things are great and some things are not and something, but like, for me, I was extremely spoiled with my first thing. And I had, you know, we were a family. The writing was amazing. The direct, like, I don't look back on Sopranos and go, well, it was good except for this thing, you know? It was just like, it was everything. It was perfect. So then to like, I think there's a part of me that's like, if you do something else, you're going to mess it up. Like, I look back on Sopranos and acting and I go, it was perfect, you know? It was great. And if I do something else, the chance of messing it up is pretty high.
tell us about the podcast, your new podcast.
So yeah, I moved 6 months ago to LA to start a podcast with Jamie Lynn. And we basically, you know, it was kind of around the time where we had the 20-year anniversary, and we were sitting in the hotel room afterwards. It was just me and her, and we're in pajama pants, and we're like, you know, we need to do this. We need to, you know, we're smoking a joint, and we're like, this is what the stupid shit we're talking about now in this conversation, we want to keep it going. And I was living in Vegas, and I was like, well, if you want to start a podcast with me, I'll move to LA. And she said, of course.
Wow.
Yeah. So it's called Pajama Pants, and we got it on, we're doing it on YouTube, and we have it wherever you get podcasts. And it's just been like, you know, it's because me and Jamie's relationship is 80% of it was Sopranos. So Sopranos does come up, but it's also like, you know, we talk about going to the bathroom and losing our virginity. And it's just, you know, it's everything.
Oh, that's great, man. So let me ask you, there was an episode later on, I don't know which one, where they asked you to shave your eyebrows.
Yeah. You
remember that? And you refused. And that was good.
Yeah.
Right?
Well, no. At first I said, okay. And then Jim was like, listen, he's like, I don't know if he was messing with me, but he's like, there's horror stories of people I know that shaved their eyebrows when they were drunk and they never grew back and this and that. So he was very much so like, whenever there was anything that made an actor uncomfortable or whatever, I feel like Jim said something before the actor
sure.
did.
He was always like that. You're right.
That would have been bad walking around for months, maybe, without eyebrows. You would have looked like a freak.
Yeah, and then what if they're like, oh, we got to go back and shoot it or this. But so they had, what I would do is I would show up to set, and they had like some Oscar-winning makeup person who did like a Dick Tracy movie or something, and he would come in. So if we had to shoot at, let's say, 6 a.m, I would have to get there at 4 to do the 2 hours of makeup. So I would sit in the chair and I'd fall asleep like this, and then you open your eyes and you wake up and there's the mirrors right in front of you, and you wake up with just no eyebrows. And it's the one thing I remember about doing the show, not from watching it but from being there, was Edie is like, oh my God. And she realizes, or Carmela realizes right away what's going on. And Jim looks at me and he just goes, what's weird about you? You know, he can't even figure out that the eyebrows are gone. And it's, it was a weird thing. And that was the kind of vibe you got from people walking around set all day. Or when I would we'd be filming and they would give you lunch and you'd go to get lunch somewhere or whatever. And I'd forget that I had no eyebrows and you would just see people looking at you super strange. And you didn't remember that you had no eyebrows. So you're like, why is this person looking at me? It
was
fun.
Was it John Caglione who did the makeup?
Maybe.
An Italian guy. He was Al Pacino's guy.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. That's because Al was in Dick Tracy, right? I think he does all of Al's movies, but he's a good guy. I've worked with him. I think he did some stuff with me on Sopranos too. He's really good.
Yeah, they were real, like, yeah. Everybody in the hair. You know, obviously I was like a kid. I didn't know shit, but all the people in the hair makeup trailer were like, oh my God, you know, they brought in the big guns.
Now you still
just did a TV show and Kimbra was the hair makeup person on it.
I miss her. She's
great.
Kimber, Steve are great. Yeah,
Kimber Callahan. Yeah.
How's she doing?
She's good. She's really good. She's gonna come on this show. And Steve, we're gonna get Steve Kelly and Kimber
to
be on the show.
You know, we had so many parties. Most shows don't have any parties, but we had like a party for everything: Christmas party, premiere, finale. You know, we had a lot of shit going on, you know, all the time, you know, with the crew, with the crew's family, you know, with their wives, their girlfriends, you could bring, you know, it was a good time. It really was a once in a lifetime thing, like you said. And now you used to own a bunch of pieces of numerous restaurants and bars. You still do?
Yeah, I had invested in a couple of restaurants and bars. No, I don't really do. You know, it's when I stopped drinking, it kind of became a thing of like, well, I'm not going there anymore. So
yeah, that's all right.
I don't know what's good and what's bad and what's not and what's so.
Well, you look good, man. You look great. You look like in shape. LA's doing you good.
Thank you. Yeah, you guys look great too.
You good
guys,
for you.
You know what's funny? One thing I wanted to bring up on the podcast is like one of the most memorable moments I was going to say of like the last few years of my life, but I think it'll be with me forever is, I don't know if you remember, Michael, but when we did the 20 year anniversary, I like my chair was all the way at the end. So everybody had walked off stage and I was like the last person. So I was walking off stage and you were standing like right in the middle of the stage and you were kind of looking out and you just seemed like, and I was like, what's up? Like, and I kind of like put my hand on your back. I was like, what's going on? And you looked out and you were like, yeah, you're like, I'm just sad that we're not going to be all together again tomorrow.
Yeah.
And that just like, it hit me so hard because it was like, obviously I'm feeling the same thing, but to, you know, for you to just, you know, I guess as like a guy, we're taught to like, you know, don't acknowledge your feelings and push things aside. And for you to just like say that exact thing at that moment and standing on stage and everybody was, it really is something that I think will stay with me forever.
Yeah. I mean, the friendship, the camaraderie is, I've never had that before or since and probably won't, you know, but we were very lucky that way. Really lucky.
Once in a lifetime deal, man.
Yeah. Without a doubt.
Listen, I love you, my friend. I'm going to come on your podcast. Thanks for coming on ours.
I'll be there too.
Yeah, and, thanks for having me.
And, you need anything, you know where to find us.
Yeah, same. Thank you guys for having me. This is
all right.
Good luck on your next move, whatever that may be.
Thanks. I can't wait to see you guys soon.
See you, all right, buddy.
Thanks, pal. Ciao.
See you soon.
Robert Iler.
Great guy. Funny guy. Good guy, knows what he wants, what he doesn't want. Hey, he should have won an Emmy in the later seasons on Sopranos. He was that
good. And I bet we have not seen the last of him in terms of acting.
Nah, he's going to pop up in something good.
And this episode that we're going to talk about today, he's particularly good in. I thought he was, his acting is, you know, throughout season one, throughout the episodes we've covered so far, his acting really shines through.
I mean, it's all done through instinct. I mean, he's a terrific actor. And most of his stuff, you know, especially the first season, I mean, he's nose to nose with Nancy Marchand, with Jim, with Edie. I mean, you know,
relaxed and true and honest.
He's with Jamie Lynn. I buy it every which way. He's a good kid, and thank you for that, Robert. I appreciate it. So, episode 7.
Season 1, episode 7.
Down Neck.
Down Neck refers to the ironbound section of Newark, where the Passaic River bends and resembles a neck, apparently. So I've heard. There's another, I think, connection to it towards the end of the episode, and we'll get to the name Down Neck. But Newark is where the flashbacks take place, where Tony Soprano grew up, and we will get into that as well.
And so Newark is where he grew up, and the Soprano house is in North Caldwell.
North Caldwell, New Jersey, yeah.
Which is how far from Newark? Do you have any idea? Not that far.
Maybe? Yeah,
not that far. But a whole a different... And Newark is right next to Belleville, which, of course, is the home of Frankie Valli, our friend.
Yeah, and Christopher Moltisanti.
There you go. So now in this episode, Down Neck, written by Mitch and Robin Green, who have been with David for years on other shows, correct? They worked with him.
Yeah, they did Northern Exposure. They did a show called Almost Grown that David was one of the creators, or maybe the creator.
And Robin was a writer for Rolling Stone.
The first woman on the staff of Rolling Stone. And she wrote a book about it. And I read the book. What's the title of the book?
I don't remember. I have it up there on my shelf somewhere.
Yeah, I think I haven't read it yet, but I've read reviews and excerpts of it. And she lived a pretty wild, '60s, early '70s hippie lifestyle.
Up in San Francisco, she got around a little bit there. And when I say get around, I mean she was running with
Dennis Hopper.
The whole
Hunter
gang.
Thompson.
It's a really good story. I had no idea. And I've known Robin now for 20 years. And I had no idea. And Mitchell was her student.
I didn't know that.
Yes. She taught. She's from Providence, I believe. And she taught somewhere in the Midwest. And that's where she met Mitch.
Iowa.
And she met Mitch. He was a writing student. And that's how they got together. Now they are married. They've been together. They also created Blue Bloods.
Robin also worked as a secretary at Marvel Comics to Stan Lee. She was his, before Rolling Stone, she was a secretary for Marvel Comics. She was Stan
Which
Lee's.
Which is amazing. She's lived.
She used to answer questions, phone calls for Stan Lee. Which is amazing.
Quite an interesting life.
Mitch is an expert on wine. You know, literally one of the most knowledgeable people about all kinds of wine, a real connoisseur. And I also have to say, Robin, when I started writing on the show in season 2 and started going into her book, Robin's book is The Only Girl, My Life and Times on the Masthead of Rolling Stone. That's Robin's book. You should get it because she's a great lady. She was very helpful to me because I had only written screenplays before. And when I was rewriting drafts of my episode, she really broke down and explained to me how television writing is different than screenplay writing. Really helped me understand how to use the cuts, you know, and how to be more concise, how to let, you know, the condensed amount of time, you know, work for the storytelling. So I'm grateful to her.
Not a lot of writers would do that. They're not all so generous with their time. And we've gone out with Robert. She hung out. Robert and Mitch hung out with us all the time.
Love them both.
All the parties.
Great people.
And a lot of fun. They created Blue Bloods. I did not get to Blue Bloods till they were gone, but they've been obviously worked on 2 incredibly successful shows. And one is still going. So thank you. And they're terrific. And I believe they're going to be on our show. So I look forward to
when we're going to have them on.
And now the director, Lorraine Senna. Is that the only female? I've never met her. I don't know anything about her. Was she the only female that directed a Soprano episode?
She was the only female that directed a Soprano episode. She directed a lot of television. She did Fame, the TV show. She did Dynasty, Knott's Landing, which Ray Abruzzo was on. I only had two very small scenes in this episode, so I did not interact with her very much. And, you know, she also did a show called Paradise, Texas that I think she was a showrunner on.
Yeah, I don't know much about it. And so we have, you know, some great guest stars. Joe Saravo plays Johnny Soprano, Tony's father. We're going to see that in a flashback. We have Bobby Borriello, who plays a young Tony. And not only, he's a terrific young actor, but not only is he played a young Tony Soprano, he played a young Howard Stern. Stern's movie, and a young Andy Kaufman in that movie, Man on the Moon. So
he's got a lot of range.
A lot of range, and he's done a good job, and he's still acting, I believe. Rocco Sisto, he played a young junior, and he does a great job. Young Janice, played by Madeline Blue. And Layla Robbins, I believe, plays the young Livia. And there you go. Michael B. Jordan, you know, who played Apollo Creed's son in these new Creed and Creed 2.
Yeah, he's one of the kids that chases young Tony. Well, in the flashback.
Sopranos make another star. Here we go. It starts out in the church. AJ and his friends are drinking wine. They're altar boys, I assume, or they're just drinking wine with the church that's attached to the school.
In the Catholic school. There's a statue. They passed a great statue of St. Jude, who's the saint of lost causes, the saint of desperate causes. So St. Jude is looking over them. And did you ever sneak the church wine?
Nah.
You didn't hang out in the church that way?
No, I wasn't involved in the church. I was never an altar boy. My friends were not my thing. And, you know, I was an athlete when I played ball. I wasn't drinking at a young age like that.
When was the first time you got drunk?
14 years old.
Me too.
14. A friend of mine's father on the block. He had a 16th birthday for a guy on my block. He had a, you know, kind of big front yard, big house. And he had a full bar. And I, my friend's cousin, I was making out with her. And it's the first time I got a little feel there. I felt up the girl. A few drinks.
You got drunk and you got...
Right on the sideway in the gravel on the side of the house there. Right?
A lot of stuff happened on the side of the house where I grew up too. I got drunk for the first time at 14 at Yankee Stadium.
Wow.
My buddy, Patsy Gruby and Kevin Ledley and... we were way up in the nosebleeds. I guess it's 79 or 80. And the drinking age was 18. So things were different then, obviously. But, I mean, I looked 14. I didn't look 18.
They didn't care. Back then, they didn't care.
They sold you beer after beer after beer. Falling down the escalators.
Well, he makes his commission. That's how the guy was making his commission.
And then got sick as a dog that night. Sick as a dog.
You know, I remember when I was a kid, I went to a New Year's party and I drank Harvey Wallbangers. Do you remember those?
What was in that? I've heard of it.
Yeah. I don't even remember, man. Something sweet, Galliano, I don't know. But I got so sick. To this day, I couldn't smell that. Harvey Wallbangers, that was a thing in the 70s, you know.
When you were young, it was 18.
The drinking age was 18. So, you know, you go in the bars at 16. Like you said, no one carded anybody. And now you go to Yankee Stadium, they card me. You know, it's an overall blanket, you know. And it should be. I'm not bragging
nobody,
about that.
Nobody should have that experience that I did at 14.
Yeah, that bad, huh?
No, I'm being sarcastic. It was kind of great, actually. It's kind of a good story. But in Luxembourg, I did a movie in Luxembourg a few years ago. The drinking age is 16. And really? On Friday nights, in my hotel was right near the main square. It would be crowded with kids. I guess they're even. So if the drinking age is 16, they look like babies walking around with bottles. You go in a bar, there's 16-year-old kids in. It's very weird.
I think that's a little too young. I mean, you know, as it is, you got guys that are in their 40s that are assholes. Drink when they drink. You know that? We all know those guys. The minute the guy's perfectly normal, you put a couple drinks in him, he becomes a complete douche, you know? So we've seen that, but so.
But this is kind of, listen, it's kind of, it seems like normal kid stuff. The three boys, they steal the wine. They make a big thing. Is he being persecuted for being Tony Soprano's son? I think maybe here.
I think you're right.
He's being a little bit singled out. Listen, you can't condone that. You got to make them deal with the consequences of that action. But it's not, you know, it's not like, you know, beating somebody up and hurting someone physically. You know, it's normal.
Well, listen, you know, they drink, then they go to gym class and you know, they're dizzy and they're goofing off and they're, you know, they're obviously very tipsy. And then the one kid gets drunk and puke, and that kid doesn't get in trouble. They pick
out that kid.
The kid that did the throwing up. AJ didn't throw up, you know. Right. So I absolutely believe that he's being prosecuted because he's persecuted because he's a Soprano. The construction site.
Yeah, Christopher with that hard hat doesn't sit right on his head.
No, it's too big for your little head.
It's like Bugs Bunny or something. It's not when he wears the army uniform, you know, and it's flopping around. It's reminded me of that.
He says, how you doing to Chris? And he says, I got dust up the crack of my ass and I'm starving.
And then I said, I got to deal with this prick. You hear that, you prick?
You know,
and Tony takes his side. Tony takes Christopher's side here. Christopher was probably being a real asshole to this guy.
Oh, absolutely. Christopher could whine at times. He's a complainer. He's not a go with the flow guy.
No, he has a bit of a prima donna attitude. Yeah, but
so they shake down the foreman, and of course the foreman he complies, right?
And they use this really cool whip pan. From that scene, the end of that scene, they do this whip pan with the camera and cut to the next scene, which is in the principal's office. You know, that director, Wes Anderson, he does that a lot. And you don't do it with special effects. It's all done in the camera. Yeah. You move the camera fast, and then you match it on the next shot. And I don't think they ever used it again on The Sopranos.
Why do you think? Was it necessary there? Did it do anything for the scene?
Probably director's choice. Maybe like, I don't know. No, it just moves the story along in an interesting direction, makes you pay attention in a certain way. Sometimes that could be a little distracting, but it kind of worked in this.
Here we are with the principal's office. He's a priest. You got Tony Carmelo and AJ in the office. The school psychologist says Anthony has trouble following the rules.
Following the rules, weighing consequences, and doesn't think before he acts. All things that his father does.
Yes, but very also strong. All things that a 13-year-old kid does.
Of course. Tony wants to pay for the wine, you know, which is like his go-to thing. He thinks his money's always going to sell. I'll pay for the wine, we're all square, you know what I mean? Like, that's going to make everything go away.
You know, but the attitude of the principal / priest and the psychologist, they're both douchebags.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, and like they said, are they testing the other kids? They want to test him for psychiatric problems. And he says, are they testing the other kids? They all did the same thing.
I mean, the psychologist, which is why he was cast, you dislike this fucking guy right away. Just that. So he's got a smug, stupid attitude. And of course, Carmela, who, like Livia, can be a drama queen. She goes, I always knew there was something.
A disease. Yeah. My son is sick.
Comparing it to polio.
Right, of course.
Right. You know, he says, Tony says, there's nothing that a couple of good, wax or whatever, do a good Donadello on his head, which is an Italian dance, on
his
head.
It means tarantula.
What's that?
Means tarantula.
Yeah, but it's also an Italian dance. We're gonna
do I know.
The Donadello.
I'm not disputing.
The Donadello on his head, and he says, you know, the priest gives the psychologist a look. Do you hit him? Because that's a whole nother can of worms.
A whole other ball game. Yeah.
And then he goes, But no one gets hit in my house, but it's not my idea. So in other words, he would hit him if he could.
He thinks he should be able to, yeah.
And I also kind of think, like we all have, I mean, I certainly got hit. I didn't get beaten, but, back in the old days, they smacked you in the back of the head. You do something
Of course.
Wrong, it was a whole...
More than that sometimes.
A whole different idea. All right, let's
You know, this. He also starts, the therapist starts with saying something nice. He goes, well, he's got strong skills in spatial orientation in art class, which is like a lame.
Yeah.
And then he goes into the bad news. The other thing I wanted to mention is in the pilot script, and at the end, after it was edited, they didn't keep it, but Tony talks about Christopher having ADD.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
I could see that.
But I don't know. I mean, there's a lot of controversy about what ADD actually is, obviously.
Well, there's a lot of people think it's, I'm not an expert by any means, as everyone knows. But is ADD something that's a kid that's hyperactive and the teacher doesn't want to deal with it, so right away let's put him on medicine?
There's Sometimes a lot of it that is shit, that.
So here we go.
Sunday, it looks like a Sunday dinner at the Soprano house. They got the pasta, the meatballs, the sausage. I noticed they're eating the pasta first. The salad is waiting for after. That's how we did it.
I never did that. Nah, never. That's a lot of Italians do that. Not for me. I know a lot of guys eat the salad afterwards. I've never done that.
Both sides of my family did that religiously. Really? In Italy, that's how they do it. Yeah.
I think the salad should be first. And
yeah, me too. I never have it first. I still do it after.
So if you order a salad, I've gone out to dinner with you 100 times. I don't notice.
I get it. If I get a pasta, I'll have the pasta first and ask for the salad.
Oh, wow.
And you have to tell them because they're not used to that in America.
So they're having the big Sunday dinner. You got Junior there. You got Meadow, AJ, Livia, Tony, Carmella. Very upset, very upsetting about this incident with AJ at school. Yes, it is. I think the ADD is what scared them. He might have this disease. She's comparing this disease to polio. Would you hit someone with polio, she tells Tony.
Well, Olivia says, they're going to suspend him with all the money you give them. She's like Tony talking about the money. Well, you pay so much money that he shouldn't get suspended, which
is I kind of agree with them. I paid a lot of money for my kid's school. What the fuck?
It's kind of a hilarious argument. Junior's like, boys would be boys. And then AJ's kind of a wise ass and Tony gets mad. And then Tony starts yelling at Junior and Junior doesn't like that.
No. Junior's a... Yeah. He's got a big ego now, and what's funny is Carmella tells AJ his punishment is no Mario Kart. I don't know what that means. Is that a video game?
I guess so.
Mario Kart, no skateboarding, and you have to go to ride your bike to your grandmother's every day. That's part of the punishment.
That's the punishment.
Livia
likes that, yeah.
She loves it. Olivia said that'll be great. She says, how much time I spent in the vice principal's office? And then they bring up Tony stealing a car when he was 10 years old. He couldn't look over the steering wheel. And Junior says he had his own crew selling lobsters on Bloomfield Avenue. So
and Tony don't like this shit coming out. He's not happy with it.
He doesn't want to talk about this at the dinner table. They're making light of it. And AJ's enjoying it. AJ's a spoiled brat.
Oh, yeah.
He's a spoiled, entitled brat. He is.
All right. It's not that big of a punishment. What, he can't play video games and go on the internet? It's not that big.
And he thinks that's very unfair. And
he don't like it.
Then they're in the Soprano bedroom afterwards, and Tony asks Carmella, do you think he knows? Meaning, do you think AJ knows that he's in the mob?
And then he asks us, do you think Meadow knows? And they use these quick little jump cuts, very, very jarring to the college episode when Meadow asks Tony if he is in the mafia.
Well, that's what Tony's really thinking about, correct?
Yeah, I like those jump cuts. They were very cool. Tony's thinking about he knows that Meadow knows, but he's not telling Carmella that he knows.
And there's a little smile on his face when he asks Carmella, hey, did she talk to you about it? And she said, talk to me. And you see a little smile like she confided in him, Meadow. He likes that. He likes that.
He likes that. But and there's also what comes up here. Tony Stark is blaming himself. He has it, and it comes in a lot of scenes in this episode. He's blaming himself for AJ's problems. And we'll get into that more, but this is the first time it really starts to come up. Actually, in the next scene is Melfi's office. And she says, do you see his behavior as a reflection of your own? And, you know, a lot of Tony's thing is that he sees everything's about him. You know, everything kind of is a reflection of his own, you know, his own feelings, his own thoughts, his own problems, his, you know, projecting on his kids, projecting to his wife, projecting on other people. And we'll see that. That comes,
but
comes
he
across
asked,
in a
he
lot.
Asked Melfi, he asked Melfi about the ADD. They talk about that. He asks if it's a disease. Once again, comparing it to polio. And now she says, last time you were here, we talked about you having intimate feelings for me. I think she wants to know more about this, not just for his sake. She's a little titillated, I think.
I don't know. I think it was avoided. They didn't really address it. It got cut off. And now he didn't bring it up again. And it's, as a professional, I could make the argument it's something that does need to be addressed. And then he sticks it to her.
Oh yeah. He got spurred. You know, he got burned a little bit. He says, I have a 24-year-old, and the look on his face too. I got a 24. How old are you? A Russian. Good. See what he says? Right. A Russian.
How are you dealing with that? How are you doing with that? He doesn't. He's trying to. He's being. You know. He's. You know. Jealous in a way. You know that she doesn't return the feelings that he expressed to her, and he says you want to raise money again. Money's gonna, you know, his power and his, you know, and money is something that he wields to control his life.
She says, you never told me about your girlfriend before. He kept that from her when he thought he had a shot with her. Now it's like, okay, you don't want to screw around with me. Look what I got. I got a 20. How old are you? He asked her how old she is. That's a fucking, you know, that's a little zing.
A zing.
How old are you?
He's zinging.
I got a 24-year-old. She's got to be at least what at the time?
Late 30s, 40?
40s, mid-40s.
She deals with it very professionally and really maturely.
Oh, she's great. Lorraine Bracco's great in this. Absolutely great. And there's a lot of, this is probably, certainly the most we've seen in the psychiatrist's office. There's a lot here.
Yeah, a lot in this episode, yeah.
All right, so Tony wakes up in the morning as Carmella and AJ are arguing.
And Meadow, too. She's yelling. Everybody's yelling.
And they're putting the music on. The fucking music is blasting. He wakes up to that. And then White Rabbits begins to play. You know,
oddly, of kind of an on-the-nose musical choice. That song's used so much in movies and TV and commercials whenever they want to. Whenever it goes into the 60s or psychedelic, it kind of jumped out as not the best musical. I like the song, but it's just been used. It's like whenever in a movie or a show, when they want the grandmother to put on a leather jacket, they play Born to Be Wild by Steppenwolf. It's like, you know, you see that in a million, you know, grandpa gets on the motorcycle. It's Born to Be Wild plays. Kind of look like that. There's other musical choices in this episode that are fantastic, but that jumped out as a little bit on the nose.
You know, I got to tell you, I wouldn't put up with Meadow and AJ for 2 seconds. Playing the music, arguing with your mother.
No.
Not for 2 seconds. Shut up. Go in your room. Shut your goddamn mouth. Shut up. Honestly, I don't play that at all. Especially, you're living in this big house. You're going to the best school. You got all the best games. You are living a hell of a life. Your backyard, your pool, your trips. You're not going to give me grief. You're not going to give me grief. It ain't going to happen. Not going to happen. Now there's a flashback after he takes the pill. It brings him back. I don't know if that's why, but it brings him back. And it's a flashback to 1967.
And here are the seeds of the movie that's coming out this year. Yes. The Many Saints of Newark. This is the first glimpse we have of this life of Tony and his family and the Soprano family in the 1960s during the Newark riots, which is right when these flashbacks start. Rocco Sisto, who plays the young Uncle Junior, actually was born in Italy, in Bari. Done a lot of Broadway, Amadeus on Broadway, a lot of experimental theater with Richard Foreman. Joe Saravo, another big Broadway guy, who was in Oslo and Light in the Piazza. He was in Carlito's Way, Witness to the Mob that I was in. And
good guy, good actor. He also was in Jersey Boys on the Road Company.
Right, Jersey Boys. And Layla Robbins also was in The Real Thing. She replaced Glenn Close in, on Broadway. And I did a reading with her 30 years ago at Circle Rep, long time ago. She's a great actress.
And
good good casting there.
And this is the first time you see the young Uncle Junior, the young Johnny Boy Soprano, and a young Livia. And a young Livia, Livia was attractive when she was young.
Looking good, yeah.
Absolutely. And so Junior arrives to pick up Johnny Boy Soprano, Tony's dad. Tony, young Tony, he's probably 8 or 9 at this time.
Yeah.
Misses the bus. In turn, he sees Johnny and Junior giving a beating to this Rocco who owes them money. They chase him down. And it's a typical mob, chase him down in the street. He owes them money, and they beat the shit out of him. Hits him over the head.
First punch is, the first punch, it's a complete miss. If you notice, when Johnny Boy punches the guy, it's a the guy reacts like he got punched, but it's a complete miss.
Yeah. No, yeah. I saw that. I wasn't going to bring that up.
That song is really good. Don't Bring Me Down by the Animals, Eric Burdon. That's a great tune. They kind of redeem... redeem themselves there.
He hits him over the head with a flower pot. I mean, they really give the guy a beating. This is, you know, 8:30 in the morning. People are all around. They're looking out their windows. There's no secret,
right?
You know who the boss is. They're not trying to hide nothing.
No. And Tony says later on to Melfi, he goes, "It looked like my father knew what he was doing when he beat this guy."
Absolutely. That wasn't the first time he did that. That's for sure. Back to Melfi's office.
He talks about this, beating up the father beating up the guy. I love how he says, "My father loved shellfish."
Yeah.
And my mother never ate anything raw. And he really kind of weighs both of them and is, you know, very disappointed in his mother because she never ate, you know, it's really kind of the thing, the bad taste in his mouth about that.
Father knew how to have a good time. He was a good guy. He liked his father. Was his father as good a guy as he portrays? You know, who knows, you know?
Well, he's defensive. He's deflecting about it. He doesn't want to talk about the illegal businesses. He turns the table. Look at all these corporations that, you know, all the dirty shit that they do. She says, "Are you concerned that your son's going to find out about you?" You know, and that's one of the important things we take from this is that, yeah, he is concerned, you know.
Oh, absolutely.
Absolutely.
And we'll see that later on as he goes deeper in with her. All right. Now they're in the back of the Bada Bing.
Right, but you know, the dancers in the Bada Bing in that scene, it's the same three dancers in the same outfits from when Jackie Jr., that we learned that Jackie Jr. was killed.
So do you think it would, they just, what do you think? You think they
I
just
think
cut
it was
a whole
leftover
bunch of that?
Footage.
Yeah, leftover footage.
From Meadowlands, episode 4, because it's the same outfit, same dancers in the same kind of
configuration. They probably just, you know, why pay them again? And let's do it. So they're in the back of the Bada Bing, which Silvio owns, and it's a big pussy. And Tony's talking about AJ. You know, hey, he says, Meadow is one thing. Silvio says his daughter gives him a hard time because she thinks the strip joint objectifies the women, the dancers. And he goes, hey, they're making $1,500 a week. You know, once again, right. Money. And you know what's funny to me? Which I completely forgot. Big Pussy sounds like a father that has his shit together.
Yes, he does.
Big Pussy.
Good relationship with his kid.
And very gives matter of fact, very confident, not wavering, gives matter of fact. Yeah, I lied to through my teeth, but they knew anyway. But who knew Big
Pussy? And they love me, he says. And they love me anyway.
Who knew Big Pussy was a father of the year?
Yes, yes.
He comes over. Then Christopher, of course, comes in. He rips off a FedEx worker, and he steals watches. And Tony gets very mad at him. You fool. What are you doing? You could face 8 years for that.
But he's more angry about his son and stuff like that.
Yeah, probably if it was a normal day and he was sitting back having a cigar, he would have gladly taken one of those watches for his wife.
Right, absolutely.
When they are testing AJ, the doctor, AJ's talking about South Park and he's completely distracted.
But he also seems like a completely normal, average kid, you know? I mean, when that picture, I looked at that picture, I thought about making a bet on a horse when I saw that picture. You know what I mean? It's like, what can you really interpret? The guy's going to watch TV. I mean, I don't know. What did you see when you saw that picture?
I saw a horse. I saw a horse, right? I don't know.
It's a horse and then a barn in the background.
I didn't pay that much attention. I was listening to AJ. Don't you watch South Park? You're a cartoon guy, right?
I've never seen South Park.
Oh, you're a Simpsons guy.
I used to be.
I thought you were
Simpsons has been on a long time. You know, it's hard to be great for. I mean, it was great for many, many years. I like American Dad. Yeah,
American Dad.
I know you've never been in therapy, but when you saw that card with the horse and the barn,
I'm gonna have to go back and look. I gotta be honest with you. All I saw was the horse. It doesn't mean anything to me. I don't know. I'm not a deep thinker. I told you.
You don't put much stock in those tests. God, I don't either.
I like the scene with Pussy, with the thing, my kids. I like that he was a good dad. A good dad, you know? He's playing pool.
He was a good dad.
Matter of fact, he's telling it like it is, Tony. Tony and Carmella have spoiled these two kids way too much, man. Too much.
I agree.
They're back in the kitchen. Okay, she's got books. She's reading books about the ADD.
She's obsessed. Yeah.
The way she becomes with everything, you know. I like Carmella. I mean, Edie's fantastic in every scene, but I like Carmella. She's a bit of a fucking pain in the ass. You know what I mean? Too much. Everything's too much. Too much jewelry. Her nails are too big. The fucking hair. Everything's too much, too much, too much. Shops too much. Showing off. And right away, goes to the store, goes to the bookstore, buys a bunch of these books about ADD and that they could possibly put him in special ed.
But that's all true, and those are legitimate concerns at the same time because, you know, as a parent, it's hard. You know, you hear these things, you don't know. Maybe there is something wrong with the kid. I mean, I see where she's coming from, but she definitely takes it end of the spectrum.
I mean, because
Tony's blaming himself in this scene again, you know, and you see that everything's a reflection of him. And she says, you blame me. He says to her, you blame me. He's blaming himself. Then he says, well, he wants to blame himself, but at the same time, he's like, well, who do we blame for Meadows? She's a straight A student, honor society, blah, 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 you know, and then she goes, what about your Ubat's Uncle Lenny? That's in his gene pool too. And then it cuts right to Livia when he says that. The Ubat's in the gene pool cut to Livia, close up again. It's
very funny. Very, very funny. Yeah,
it is very funny.
But she says she's got two eyes, so she knew what she's getting into. She doesn't say no, Tony. She doesn't assure him. It's not your fault. She doesn't say, not your fault. What are you talking about? You're crazy. I don't mean that. She thinks it's his fault.
Yeah, she's also admitting her own involvement, her own hand in it. I got two eyes. I made a choice. I made a conscious choice to be involved in this, so I can't be blameless either.
So AJ,
the whole thing about blame is, you know, it's a very common thing, and it's some ways it's kind of useless. Blaming,
of course,
my
it is.
Fault.
But I also think I think they're very nice to their kids, and they want the best for them, but. They're not disciplined, these two.
No, they're making some mistakes.
They're very spoiled here. Livia, he goes to the retirement home, which is part of his punishment. Livia is happy to see him. AJ comes over. He's happy. She introduces him to the friend.
She's very kind to him and very present and, you know, upbeat.
Absolutely. Cool. AJ says he's seeing a psychiatrist. She's appalled at that.
Appalled.
That they would... send AJ, you know, test him at psychiatry, anything on this, as far as she's concerned, just a regular 13-year-old kid.
I agree with her.
Yeah, I'm with you.
Lying in school, and now they're testing him for mental illness.
Absolutely, positively. They sent you to a psychiatrist. That's nothing but a racket for the Jews. Nice. Great line. It's very funny. AJ tells us, Olivia, that Tony's seeing a psychiatrist. She does not believe him. She's going, come on.
But then she's thinking all he does, that makes sense now, that he goes and complains about her and blames her for all the problems in his life.
She knows what's coming.
She knows exactly what's
coming. At the beginning of the episode, when it cuts to her, she's reading the obituary with a magnifying glass. I read the obituaries every day. Do you?
You do. No.
Every day. I read the ones in Vegas and the ones here every day. It's a very morbid thing. When you're older, I'm older than you. Fucking people dying. You know a lot of people in the paper. It's very sad. You don't have nothing to do with that.
I mean, the Times, yeah, the obituaries. That's true. I would do that. But those are famous people.
Not everybody's famous in the Times. They got regular notable civilians.
Do they in the obituary?
You put up the money, you're in the New York Times obituary. If it means there that much go to you.
It's all about money, like Tony Soprano, huh? She says, I gave my life to my children on a silver platter, and this is how they repay me. So much is about appreciation and guilt trips. I mean, that's real family shit. I mean,
it's good to see her. I like seeing that she's in a better mood. I like that.
Yeah. But here's also the seeds of the narcissism that Tony has. That it's all about her. You know what I mean? He's there complaining about her. He can't be going to a psychiatrist for his own reasons, right?
And she doesn't know that for sure. She's assuming, and she happens to be,
of course,
1,000% right. Tony and AJ, they're in the car on the way to the dentist. They get a flat tire. They talk.
Nice scene. Nice father and son moment.
AJ, Robert was great in this.
Great acting.
Great, beautiful.
They're
fixing the flat. AJ says we should call the auto club. Spoiled, call the king, pay the money. What's the difference? And he says, in this house, we change tires.
Right, but he doesn't really teach him how to do it.
No.
But
he says that.
He doesn't show him how to do it. He doesn't make him do it.
He asks him what he knows. And he says, kids, but AJ knows. Meadow told him.
Yes, he knows, but he doesn't, you know. And he's honest and says, some kids have said you're in the mafia. And how do you feel about that? And he says, I don't know. But it's a nice moment of, you know, this kind of connects to the last scene of the episode with the two of them together. And it's a nice moment of honesty between the two of them.
And he tells him, what about Jackie's? Uncle Jackie's funeral and the Godfather 1, which it was similar. And he went on the internet and he says, did you see me on the web? He says, no. So there's still a doubt, I guess, still a question mark.
No one can still hide.
Melfi's office. He tells us he's going crazy with all this shit about what AJ knows, what he doesn't know. Melfi said, you said you had the dream about the ducks. That's, they fly away with his penis, right?
That's in the pilot, yeah.
Yeah. Terrible's going to happen to your family. Is this the terrible thing? She wants to talk about his father. I don't think this is the terrible thing. The ADD.
No, but he's scared, you know. He's scared of the genetics and what kind of legacy, what he's giving his kids and what kind of legacy, you know, if there's, you know. Tony's also suffering from anxiety and depression, is on Prozac. Maybe he's thinking his kid's going to have to be on. That's the other thing. Steve, we want to give a shout out to our good friend, Terry Winner, the great writer of The Sopranos, Boardwalk Empire, Wolf of Wall Street, Final. Last week, we read the new lines that David Chase wrote for the characters of The Sopranos as they relate to coronavirus, which was a big hit. By the way, New York Magazine published it. It went to a lot of news outlets. It was the fans really loved it. And Terry Winner contributed to those lines. And David Chase wanted me to let everybody know that. And Terry's a really funny guy, a brilliant writer, and a good friend of ours. And we want to thank you, Terry.
Yeah, thank you, Terry, very much. He's a good guy, a really good guy, and he'll be a guest on soon. Yeah. And listen, people love the lines. The first new line since 2007 for characters of The Sopranos. So thank you, yeah. And we'll see you soon.
All right, we're going to go back to the episode, Melfi and Tony thinking and discussing some of the choices that Tony's made.
And most wise guys don't want their son to go into the business.
Like other parents, they want their kids to do better than them. They want them, their kids to be professionals.
Like even in The Godfather, he wanted Michael to be, a senator.
Judge or a senator or something.
And a lot of wise guys' kids are not in the world. Some are, sure. But some become doctors and dentists, and they get out of that.
Actors.
Their fathers don't want them to have anything to do with that. And I would feel the same way. But
yeah,
there's also that pride. I guess there's also that pride. Their son's in the family business.
Sure.
You see Tony playing.
She leaves them with that quote, those who cannot remember the past are doomed to repeat it, which is a lot of what this episode is about, with his memories. That's a George Santayana quote, who was a philosopher and poet professor. But this is a lot about the past and, history and what you're going to take from that and how you're going to change your life or deal with your life in the present. But yeah, we go back. There's that Holly song playing back to 1968, Carrie Ann. Junior is playing catch. They relate a lot on baseball.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, Junior's a baseball fan. Right at the beginning, did you hear the game last night? Not see the game. Did you hear that maybe the Yankee games weren't on TV then? Did you hear Joe Pepitone?
Joe Pep, yeah.
Joe Pepitone, who played for the Yankees. He was a Brooklyn guy. Italians, they loved him. He was a could have been a great player. He fucked everything off. He was just a fuck up. I read his biography years ago, his autobiography, and he was as talented as anyone. And I think one year he was making his salary for the Yankees was $6,000 in the early 60s, and his tab was like $3,500 at the Copa.
$3,500
at the Copa.
$6,000 was his salary.
$3,500 really? At the Copa. He would go.
They probably spend that on sunflower seeds now. That's like the budget for one player for sunflower.
Back then, he would go with Billy Martin and Whitey Ford, Mickey Mantle, big drinkers, all big drinkers, big partiers out every night. They were the kings of New York. Pepitone could have been one of the best. And,
nice guy. I've met him. I like him a lot.
Yeah, I've never met him. He's got a
very big, cool.
He wears a big gray wig, right?
Nice guy. Yeah, he's cool.
Well, you don't want to admit to his wig.
I don't remember his
he
wig.
He wears a big giant wig. He's
good for him.
Been bald since he's in his 20s. It's okay. You can tell the people he wears a wig.
I don't remember the wig. I remember him.
You don't want to give him up. You don't want to snitch.
I don't remember the wig. I'm telling you.
Back to Melfi's office. She says, why were you thinking about your uncle? He was thinking about his uncle playing catch with him, and there's a smile on his face. And
We're jumping back and forth between Melfi and the flashbacks. And
those were good times for him. And then for the first time, we hear about Janice, his sister Janice, who's older than him, his older sister. He has two sisters, Tony Soprano, a younger one, I believe, Barbara. Yeah. A younger one, Barbara, and an older one, Janice. He's in the middle, and he says she's a wannabe dothead. He tells she's got a new name, and this is beginning. We hear Janice, and we know what happens to Janice down the road. What a lunatic when we finally meet her. But this is the first time we hear about her.
We hear about her.
And the father takes Janice in the car. Young Tony is jealous. He doesn't understand it. Where is she going with my dad in the convertible? And she gives him the finger. So this has been going on. Janice and Tony have been battling from when they were, before they were teenagers.
Yeah, and a lot of jealousy, and that which particularly stings when you're a kid. Which weird, right? So they're watching the TV's on in the house, and it shows scenes of the Newark riots.
Yes.
And Tony, little Tony says, I want to go outside. She goes, well, take a bat with you. You see what's happening yeah. down at Jefferson Avenue.
How she let him go. Yeah. He says he's going to the CYO. But before that, he's badgering her. You know, he's badgering her. You always favor Janice. Why does she get to go? Why did I go? He wants an organ. He wants the electric organ. And Livia threatens to poke his eye out with the big fork. And Melfi's face, the look she gives to Tony, like, no wonder why you're so fucked up.
Right, yeah.
You know, he thinks it's no big deal, and maybe it's not. You know, she wasn't really going to do it. But she looks at him like, you know.
That's extreme, yeah.
Boy, you no wonder why you got fucking problems up the wazoo, man. You know, Tony hides in his father's trunk.
Great song here. One of the best. Mystic Eyes, them, Van Morrison on vocals.
David
great
must,
song.
David must be a big Van Morrison fan.
Yeah, that song really
use him
pops.
A lot.
Yeah, he's great.
Father takes Janice to the amusement park. Tony hides in the trunk, very smart. He gets in there. You know, he makes sure he doesn't get locked in. And then he explains to Melfi his heart was broken. He still has that feeling in the pit of his stomach. He finds out. He's been taking Janice to the amusement park, and then he finds out his father's not like the other dads, he says.
Right. He gets chased by three black kids. This is played by
Michael B. Jordan.
Great actor. Good guy.
He's a really good actor. He's a big star. Became a big, big
He was a little kid. I guess he must have been like 10 or 11 back then from the Soprano days.
He flashes back to the amusement park. He finds out that his dad did something wrong. They're arresting him. You know what I love? They got the clown.
There's perfect.
Clown in handcuffs.
Great detail, yeah. Right.
Uncle Junior's in handcuffs. Johnny Boy Soprano. And when he comes out, he looks like a gangster. Joe Saravo. He's cocky as a motherfucker.
He's great. Joe cocky. Is great in that. Yeah,
he's
really
cocky.
He's
a good-looking guy. He's fucking... You know, and somebody
Joe
else.
Joe played John Gotti in Nick Sandow's movie, The Wannabe.
Yeah. Really good guy. He sees them get arrested, you know, once
but
again.
But a very traumatic thing to see.
For a nine-year-old kid, it sure is.
Yeah. My friend, when we were on the, you know, hanging out, and one of my friend's father got arrested in front of us one day. We were about the same age. It was horrible. Basically for numbers or something, you know, some minor kind of thing like that. But it was, you know. The same kind of thing, but yeah, it was horrible. Traumatic thing.
So Olivia's sticking up for, you know, before he gets home, before Johnny Boy gets home, Olivia's sticking up for him. She's smoking a cigarette, and she's sticking up for him. It's the cops arrested the wrong guy, and he comes in with ice cream.
And they persecute the Italians.
Exactly. And they sit out and gives the kids ice cream, all as well. And I remember when my father would come home. You know, my father would hang out. Like I told you, he's a small-time bookmaker. And he would sometimes bring things home from Coney Island. That's where he was. He was a bookmaker, you know, in Coney Island. And he would bring, I remember, bringing like a little reel-to-reel tape recorder or bringing a dress home for my mother. You know, hot stuff, you know. Shit that fell off the truck. And that was kind of a big deal. Oh, look what daddy brought home, you know. We were too young to realize. You know, I don't think he stole it, but he bought it or somebody gave it to him. But he brings the ice cream home. It's a gift. They're happy. And she sticks up for him.
And the Rascals are on television. The Young Rascals singing.
They're watching Ed Sullivan.
Which Steve Van Zandt inducted them into the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, which is how David saw him and thought of him for the show. That's that connection. Jersey band, too.
Yeah. So they're back in Melfi's office. This is the part, Tony says, this is the part I'm supposed to tell you what a terrible father he was. How terrible his father was. But he says, I'm proud to be Johnny Soprano's kid. Do you think that's how your son feels about you?
Right.
She says to him. Probably, and I'm glad he's proud of me, but that's the bind I'm in. He doesn't want AJ to be like him. He says, have you communicated this to your son? And he says, we in my family, we don't communicate. You're born into this shit. He's convinced that he had no choice and maybe AJ's going to have no choice. You are born into this world.
Preordained, and she says, no, it's you're not preordained. You know, you have a range of choices. You are born into a certain part of the world in a certain time, but you have a range of choices. This is America. And he says, I want my son to do whatever he wants. What did he say? My friend's father invented the tie on the salami. He became a millionaire sitting millions. On his ass. I don't know. Sitting on his ass, he said.
And then it's very his father got arrested for, hanging out with undesirables. He was on parole when he was younger. And they told him that he was in Montana being a cowboy. They never told him he was in jail. And they used to do that, too. Because I have a friend of mine, maybe 20 years ago, and they told his kids that he was away working the same bullshit. He went away for 9 months, white-collar crime on Wall Street, a guy I grew up with. And he told the kids, I don't know if they know. I would imagine now they do, but they were younger.
What did they say?
They told him that he was out in California working, for work. He could never come back. He was there at his job. He had a big job on Wall Street. In the meantime, he did 9 months in federal prison or whatever. And then he was on probation. He was in a halfway house. So I guess they still pull that. If the kid's young enough, anyway.
Now he brings up the idea of going to Reno, Johnny Soprano, to Livia, and starting out like Michael Corleone, I guess.
Yeah, to Reno. Reno, which is a hillbilly town, which... Believe it or not, I believe might be older than Las Vegas, but it's we were there. We were in Reno. Remember? I remember you got mad at a guy. You were playing blackjack. A guy came up to you. We had more than a few drinks in us. We were in Tahoe.
We did? Yeah. I'm shocked. And I'm shocked to hear that.
We were doing something up there, and the guy was going, hey, Chrissy, you were playing blackjack. I was standing behind you. Hey, Chrissy, come out. Put me on the show. And you fucking got pissed. You went, I've been working for fucking 20 years. Fucking working. You think this is a fucking joke? You just teed off on this motherfucker.
Probably because I was playing blackjack. I don't like to be bothered when I play
blackjack. And the guy was in your face, and he was being an asshole. And, he was saying, I could be on the show, which obviously, while The Sopranos was going on, we all had that. Every fucking guy with a vowel at the end of his name thought he should be on the show. Every fat, sweaty Italian guy thought that they could be an actor. For real.
Well, some of them did.
Yes, they did. Myself included. But
no, not you. I don't mean you.
There was a lot of that.
Some people. Yeah,
we were doing something in Tahoe, and I don't know why the fuck we were in Reno, but we were...
We did an appearance.
Sounds like a country song. Why the fuck are we in Reno?
Me, you, Jim Gandofini, Steve Van Zandt, and Tony Sirico.
That was a good one.
Yeah.
All right. Retirement home. Junior visits Livia. Olivia is about to tell Junior about Tony. I believe she's going to tell Tony.
Junior
that Tony's seeing a psychiatrist, and who walks in? Tony.
Yeah, and then she has this ammunition against Tony, which is a big deal. She knows that she brings this up to Junior. Once Junior has this information, that the whole mob is going.
Oh, yeah.
The guy's in charge.
Absolutely.
This is a big exposure for Tony if this gets out into the world. I loved how Johnny Soprano said, you're like an albacore around my neck. That's great. One of the many, many malaprops.
But when, is it, am I, think I'm right. When Johnny asked Livia, right, about going to Reno, and she shoots him the fuck down.
He says,
we're not going nowhere. I'd rather smother the kids. He says, I'll go without you. I'll smother the kids. This is what she says. But is Rocco, the guy who's inviting him and said that he could run the supper club, is that the Rocco that he beat up?
Yes, the guy who yells out the window and congratulates him.
They beat him up. Yeah. Now he's inviting Johnny Soprano to go to Reno, a new venture, blah, blah, blah.
And he became a billionaire.
Becomes a billionaire, she says later on. So Rocco did okay. Johnny had that chance to get out, and she was not having it. And he, what I like what Johnny says, always with the drama. You know, drama, he goes back at her. All right, so then Junior comes to the retirement.
Junior's dressed up. Junior's dressed very, he's very dapper in this scene. So he's playing the role now.
Oh, sure.
You know what I mean?
Sure.
And he's feeling his oats. She doesn't tell Junior because Tony shows up. And Junior, kissing his ass, says to Tony, look at him, he's keeping his hair. He's not really keeping his hair. I don't know what he's talking about. And Livia says, oh, look at you, Mr. Sensitive. Maybe you should talk to a psychiatrist.
She gives it right to him. Yeah, absolutely.
He starts bringing up, why didn't you let that go to Reno? You prevented him from doing it. You know, and she's saying, I never stopped him from doing anything he didn't want to do, you know.
And he tells her that she's the real mob guy.
She says, I don't know what you're talking about. There's a statue behind them in that scene that's very similar to the statue outside Melfi's office that we see in the pilot, which is very interesting. Very, very, very similar of a young woman. I love how Livia also tells Tony how Junior's really full of himself now. That
she plays both sides the whole way. She is evil on every fucking level, boy. I got to tell you. Calling hits on people, you know, manipulating Junior. You know, Junior's not the brightest guy.
No, he's easily played, obviously.
He's older. He's also older there, you know. Back to the school psychologist. They're giving him the results. So once again, this bullshit artist gives him some bullshit results. He's this, his pediatrician.
He doesn't wait his turn. He's always on the go. But he interrupts.
But he
and
gives
he fidgets.
Good stuff first. He gives the good stuff, the bullshit stuff.
Oh, he says he's normal physically. He's psychologically, you know, pretty much mental stuff is all good. But the one of the best lines in the show, I think, what constitutes a fidget? Great. Great line. And I think Tony's, you know, I mean, I'm kind of been hard on Tony, talking about him being narcissistic and selfish and manipulative. But here he's a good dude. He's a good guy. I think this scene and the next scene are really instrumental in like the audience really getting behind him, because he defends his son. He says he's a kid who made mistakes. He's not a case. You know, you see a problem, you turn it into a disease.
Exactly.
He defends his son, and I think he's right on the money. And, you know, listen, like all of us, we have our bad sides and good sides. And Tony, this show wouldn't have worked if Tony didn't have good sides and honorable qualities. And it really comes through in this scene. And
well, listen, he loves his family. You cannot deny that.
But he's right, too.
He's 1,000% right. This doctor is a fraud and a jack-off. Completely. Tony had enough, gets up, come on, we're out of here. And Carmela agrees with him. And of course she says, we don't have to pay for the test.
We shouldn't pay for the test, again.
She agrees with Tony, and it's a good thing she did, because the audience would have been fucking pissed off, as I would have been, if she would have, you know, got mad at Tony for, why did you do that? This guy's a fraud. It's very obvious.
No, look, there's a reason why people fell in love with Tony Soprano, and this is one of the reasons.
Absolutely.
Because he did, for all his faults and all his selfish behavior, he also took care of his family, and he loved his family. And he could be an honest, fair guy as well.
Tony's watching the History Channel. He's on the, what is that? Machine
Admiral Nimitz.
What is that?
He's on the elliptic. He's watching Admiral Nimitz. Yeah. Something about
elliptical.
He's
is that
on
it?
The elliptical machine. Yeah.
Okay, so he's watching the History Channel. AJ's doing his homework.
Looks really tired. Like he really worked out. He's sweaty. He's a little.
He's
out
in good
of breath.
Shape. He's in good shape. There, Jim. Tony, Jim.
But when he comes upstairs.
Yeah.
To see AJ, he's playing that he just worked out, and it's very real and believable.
Yeah. No, for
sure. Good acting moment.
But I'm just saying, he's Tony Soprano's in good shape.
Yeah, he works out.
He's in good shape. You know, AJ's tells him he's depressed. He's feeling sorry for himself. He doesn't like being grounded. It's not fair. He still comes up with the not fair. He's just not taking his thing. And Tony kind of feels bad for him. And he knows says, it's not that big, right. not that big a fucking deal. You know,
and he says it's not fair. And Tony says, you got that right. Basically saying life isn't fair. You know what I mean? Sometimes you got to deal with shit.
But, you know, also, you know, taking all these tests and stuff, you could fuck a kid up a little. You know, they're making accusations here. You know, the kid drank a little wine. He was one of three kids.
Yeah, you can get it into their head that they have, you know, problems. And they don't necessarily. He made a mistake. He was impulsive, like kids do.
So as you get older, you realize that, you know, when you're younger, doctors, teachers, priests, they know it all. The parents in the old days believed everything. If the priest said it, it was true. If the teacher said it, it was true. If the doctor said it, it's got to be true. As the years have gone on, we have learned to think for ourselves and do research and ask for second opinions. It's not like, oh, the teacher said it. That's it must be true. That's that. You know?
Their word is God. No,
that's bullshit.
Not.
You know? You know, I went to school to be a teacher. Did you know that? I ever tell you that?
I did not.
Okay. So I went to Brooklyn College. I graduated. I went to school and phys ed was my major. And I was going to be a gym teacher. So you got to do the student teaching. I think there's one semester where you do it on the campus, and then you got to do